So yeah, the slides are also on the workshop page. So you find the address also in the Google Calendar. It's github.com/mtenicus/tmap-workshop. So there are also the slides, the first link. Okay, so let me just kick off. So yeah, TMap is a package for thematic maps in R. So basically, if you plot spatial data, you want like you plot data with ggplot. You want to assign certain characteristics of the map to be linked to data variables. So for instance, you want like a bubble map, the size of a spatial point to be mapped to, say, the size of a bubble. So that's basically thematic map. So statistical information, that's like the data behind the spatial objects. So normally you would have like an SF object, which has like several data variables, like for instance, income per country, number of the population size, data variables, which you can map. And that's the whole idea about thematic maps. And there are, of course, other packages by which you can do that. So it's not just TMap, but it's also like comparison between those packages. And I guess most of you are familiar already with it or have heard of the packages before. So there's this plot function, so a generic function, which is implemented by the packages that define classes for spatial objects. So SF raster mainly. So SF for vector-based, raster for raster. And the plot function, it gives you just a plot. And you have to do a lot of lot by yourself in order to make a really nice map. And it's only static. So ggplot, a well-known package for a general data visualization package. And you can also create maps with it. A couple of years ago, it was not really good for maps, but nowadays with geom_sf, it's becoming much better. It still has some limitations, but it's a good alternative. Leaflet, that's an R package built on top of the JavaScript library Leaflet, and that's for interactive maps. And if you make a map with R Leaflet, then you also require some code, especially if you want a nice fancy map like choropleth or bubble maps. To get things like the legend right, it takes some effort, basically. So one of the main purposes of TMap was to reduce the effort so that users can get a nice map straight away. So that was the aim. MapView, that's another really excellent package. So it's for interactive maps. And I think the strong point is that you just can explore spatial objects in a quick, nice way. It's quite similar to what TMap has function QTM, which you will see. But the main advantage of MapView is it's much lighter weight. So I don't know if you try to install TMap yet, but TMap has quite large dependency tree because it's high level, because there's so many things automatically. And MapView and same for Leaflet, they're just plotting packages. Whereas TMap has like ggplot, I think it's quite a similar abstraction level. It has some intelligence behind it. So what kind of color palettes do you use depending on the type of data? And so it does some analysis and things like that, which require other packages. Yeah, so what is that based on ggplot? It's not like, I thought, okay, let's make a package that does the same thing as ggplot. It eventually turned out to be like that. I'll talk about history the next slide, one of the next slides. But the main thing about TeamMap, which the other packages don't have, is two modes. So plot mode for static maps and view mode for interactive maps. Yeah, so I have the link to the Journal of Statistical Software paper with some code and demo data set and the development side. So there is also a lot of examples and of course the issue list. I had the examples, some references, tutorials, presentations, blogs about it, and so you can just browse around. There's also this demo folder in which are a couple of scripts. For instance, this one. And you can just run it. The figures are not there. I'm not sure why, but it's a chapter in the GSS paper. Okay, so back to the presentation. Yeah, so for the history, just briefly. So I started with some plot functions for the Netherlands. Then I tried to generalize it, call it geo. The name was not accepted by CRAN, because the name was too general, so I had to rename it to TMAP. First release came out. Eventually, in last year's TMAP 2.0, in which I migrate the underlying code from SP to SF. So SP is also a package for spatial objects, but it's quite ancient already. So SF is now a much better package. And recently, the sort of latest CRAN version is 2.3. It has, among other things, Shiny integration. If you have time, I'll show how to do that. And the version that I will plan to release after this workshop is 2.3/1. So I haven't found any bugs yet during the morning session, but it could be that there is in the session things that are unclear, or at least my experience, if there are many people using it, then there's always things that are going to be improved though. So, but for this workshop, I recommend to install the GitHub version. It's in the page on the TeamMap workshop. You can find the code. So it's you need package DevTools. Yeah, you can find it here. So library DevTools, and if you don't have it, install it. And then it's install_github. /tmap, so this code. So maybe it's good that you already try to do that, or of course feel free to use the CRAN version, then you just install the package as usual. If you have any problems or questions so far?
Is it preferable to install 1 and 2?
Second? Yeah, exactly. From this one, it's essentially the same. It's just some minor bugs that I have fixed recently. Either one is fine, but this one is more stable, I would say. What's the thing? So if the installation doesn't work, it most often is the case that some of the dependencies won't be able to install. For instance, RCPP. In that case, you have to just install packages, RCPP, and run it again. Same thing with digest, yeah. That's always the case with a lot of packages that you have to install. So does it work here? Good. Oh yeah, it's the same thing. Install packages and then RCPP. Then it asks whether you want to restart session, and you do yes.
Sure.
So that's. Oh, that's
It's working.
Okay. Strange.
No, it's changed another way.
Yeah, then try to install RCPP. Is it a normal way?
Just run this.
No. Let me see. So packages, just install in a normal way RCPP. So there's some problem with it, and if you install it again, then he asks to restart the session, and you click yes.
Okay.
Would you do this? So install. So packages, and then install. And then RCPP. And then he asked yes, and then. And then, yeah, I think you have. Yeah, if this runs, then you can try it that again. Probably ask for digest as well. So that's I'm not sure why, because they're quite well known packages, but
try to reinstall it's just on the iTunes.
Okay. I think it doesn't really matter. Okay. Yeah, can if our tools is finished, then you can try to run this again.
Yeah.
Okay. It's only a couple of them. Are you working?
No, it's
good.
It's running.
Yeah.
Server here.
Okay.
Without the dependencies, but that's good.
Cross talk. Okay. I think it's. Oh, it should be fine then.
So that's good. Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, doesn't matter. Cross talk. Yeah, you can try to install cross talk. No more way. Okay, I think most of you have succeeded. You have to stand on the line, then run. Yeah, sure. Oh yeah, the second E have to be away. Second. Before. I first, yeah, the second letter first, yeah. And then add, yeah. Exactly. And what you can do is if you stand on the line and then control enter, then it runs that line and you don't have to click any time. And let me see if it goes. Did you already have the installation?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah. You have to make sure that all the these packages are installed correctly. Yeah. Okay, and if not, let me know. Okay. Yeah. I have to install the growth to get you help of TM Bubbles. I'll go to that in the session. So, okay. So most of you, almost all of you, have the installation already, and if not, yeah, I can help. I can help later on. What's the installation? Is it correct? Yeah. Okay. So in the package, I have a couple of data sets in order to get you started. So G3, so you can load them with this command. So you see in the environment you have now the Land, Metro, World. You can of course also use other spatial data and bring all the spatial data into R. So after the break, so I'll continue until 3 o'clock. And then we have a half an hour coffee break. And after the coffee break, it's just hands-on session. So probably you have somewhere some data, and if not, you can download a CSV file, for instance. For instance, crime data that also show. And otherwise, yeah, if you have own data of your own, of one of your own projects, use them, because then you already have a feeling with the data and you learn how to bring it into R and how to visualize it. But for this demo, I'll use World, Metro, and Land. So World is a, let me show you. So World is SF object. So yeah, I can better do in a view. So it just has rows, columns. So just like a normal data frame, one column is geometry. So in this geometry, probably if you followed one of the lectures of Etzer, then you know that geometry is the specification of the geometry. In this case, polygons. And because the world is, where is it? So let me show you the plot, the shape object. QTM world, then either it shows it interactively or TMAP. So if TMAP mode, so there are two modes, plot and view. So if you go to plot mode and I run it, then I have this map over here. And if I do TMAP mode view, execute it, and then QTM, I have it over here. Some of you, probably all of you, have it in here, in the viewer. What if you restart, so let me restart R and show you how to get there. And so first, if you start R Studio again, and then do library TMAP. And if you now, so by default, it shows the map in static, so in a plot pane. If you then do TMAP mode view, it says switches to interactive viewing. And if you do the QTM world again, then it goes into interactive mode in the viewer pane. So yeah, you can do it in a viewer pane. What you can also do is send it to the browser. So there's two ways to do that. So first is this little icon here. So it just applies to any interactive plot, not just for TMap. So this little icon, and if you click on it, then it goes into the browser. And for those of you who always want to use the browser, what you can do is this command. So options viewer is null. If you run this line, then it always skips this viewer pane and sends the plot directly to the browser. Some questions so far?
I can't see the icon.
Yeah, this icon. Yeah, for some, I also had it in the morning session. For some, this icon isn't there in RStudio. Yeah, if that's the case, you can run this one. If you run this one, then if you plot a map in view mode, then it goes automatically to the browser. Yeah, I'm not sure how to do that. Let's check. I think it should be here, the viewer. Or is it an RStudio thing? Viewer. No, I think it's an RStudio option. I'm not sure how to do that. Options. No, I'll check it out. Okay. So yeah, for the TMap thing. Yeah, so QTM is used just to explore spatial objects, just as they are. So for instance, Metro is this one. So you can click on spatial objects and you see the data behind it. So it's this case. Let me zoom in the font size. So the name, long name, the ISO A3 from the country, and then the population size for different years. And so there's the QTM Metro and the QTM Land. It's a raster brick. So it's a raster of multiple layers. In this case, land cover class.
Where did you get that?
So I did QTM land.
Oh, yeah.
This one, yeah. And by default, rasters are plotted. All the variables are plotted because it doesn't really make sense. Like polygons, for instance, this one, you can just draw polygons. You can just draw points, but you can just plot raster without the data. So then by default, it just selects all the layers in the raster object. Yeah, you had a question. Which settings button? This one? Yeah, otherwise we can check it later. I think it's... Or is it here? Yeah, I can check it with you, yeah. Yeah, so the QTM is powerful if you just want to show the spatial objects. But often you want like a core plot or a bubble map. So I'll show both of them. So TM shape world plus TM polygons. And then you can define. So you see already here, the first argument is cool. So it's the color of the polygons. So you can do purple. And then you have purple polygons. But what you can also do is check what variables are in there. So what I did is names world. Then you can see all the names. And what's interesting, maybe the footprint. Well, we can... just copy the footprint, paste it here. So now you have a choropleth in which the variable footprint is mapped to the color aesthetic. So in this case, yeah, it chooses to have four categories. And you can still click on the country and see the data value behind it. Luxembourg is the largest footprint. So, and if you want to increase the number of classes, for instance, so let me repeat the map into plot mode. So TTM, the TTM stands for toggle thematic map, and it's a very lazy way to toggle between modes. See, so now I'm in plotting mode. If I then repeat, so what I do is then arrow up. For those of you who know who don't know the console yet so well, so arrow up, then you go to the previously executed commands. So if I repeat the plot, I have it in plot mode. So what I can do here is n is 12, for instance. Then I have a very large number of classes. You see that there are actually more than 12, because it's similar to, I don't know if you know this function called pretty. Pretty does is find nicely rounded class intervals. So if you have like pretty, so for from 1 to 10, find 5 classes, then you get this one. But also for 6. So it searches for the number, the nearest number of classes such that the classes are well rounded. So the same apply for this map. So the range is from 0 to 16. So now he chooses classes, breaks of a range 1. So from 0 to 1, 1 to 2, 1, 2 to 3, etc. Yes? Yeah, so the n is the preferred number of classes. So if the preferred number of classes is only 3, yeah, then he'll stick like this. So you can just play around with it. And apparently has like 3 logical break sizes, 1, 2, or 5. So in this case, break size is 2. So the step size is 2. And yeah. What you can also do is change the style. So the style, for instance, yeah, you see the continuous, for instance, cont. And then you have like a continuous. Now, of course, you can also change the labels here. And if you stand on the function, yeah, just any function in R, and press F1, you go to the help. You can also do this one. So polygons, same. Then go to the documentation. And so there's a whole bunch of arguments. So it might be a little bit intimidating, but once you know the arguments, once you know how they're structured, so the col is the main variable that specifies the color of the polygons, then yeah, the first argument to speak by itself, so the alpha transparency, color palette, I'll talk to that in a minute, and some other. And style is how the classes are defined. So it's from the package class intervals. And so by default is pretty. It's this one. And yeah, you can choose logarithmic scale, etc., fixed scales, continuous, like this. Yeah, for the color palette. So let's repeat the plot without the style. I think you can change it as well, yes. I think you can do the breaks. Let me check. I think this should work. Yeah, so now he has, well, It's a little bit small map because of the low resolution, but you can, the breaks now work as like in limits, upper and lower. To 20 it also goes, but then it throws a warning that there are values less than the lower bound, and I think they're either, yeah, I think they're rounded down to the lower bound in this case. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so the palette is so I will talk about styles, but the default palettes are, if you do tmap underscore options, you get a whole list of settings which are set by default. So in this case, for instance, base maps. These are the tile servers that correspond to interactive maps. These tile servers. And you can change that. You can change the default base maps with tmap options. And similar, so I'll not go to detail yet. So there's lots of examples in the documentation. But for the palettes, it's yes, somewhere here. Yeah. So these are the palettes. So there are three default palettes depending on the variable. So there are, if you think about what kind of variables there are in this one, what kind of variables there are, I basically have three groups. So the qualitative variables, categorical. In this case, it would be, for instance, continent. It's a categorical variable. So it's either Europe, Asia, North America, South America, Asia, Africa, whatever. There's no order in it. It's not like Europe is higher than Africa or vice versa. So that's one is the categorical, and what those values means I'll say in a minute, but categorical. Then there's the sequential. These are the numbers, for instance, population estimation, numbers that are either only positive or only negative. And then you have like a color palette that goes from, say, a light color to a dark color in a gradient way. But there are also diverging color palettes which have both negative and positive values. So those are called diverging palettes. And one way to choose a palette and also to find out what those values means, probably some people know our color brewer, and those names are referred to color brewer palettes. But in tmap tools, there is a function called palette explorer. If you run this one, then what you get is a Shiny app with all the palettes that are available in tmap. It's not limited by that. You can have any other palette that you want, but these ones are available by name. So say, for instance, if you want, so I have to stop this one. If you want this footprint, let me check the default palette. So the default is from yellow to red. So from yellow, orange, red, this one. So if you want, for instance, purple, purple, red, RG, yeah. Then what I do is like palette is blue red. So then I have purple red. So back to the explorer. So these are this for sequential like footprint. And what you can do, change the number of colors, change the contrast range, and this is not trivial, because for NE3, by default, you choose a smaller contrast range. So that means the light colors are light, but are not super light. And the dark colors are dark, but not super dark. Whereas if you choose 20 colors, then these are super dark and these are super light, just to create more contrast. And of course, you can change both of them. So just by running this code, it's from TMap Tools, you get a palette. But if you go down and say code generator, TMap layer function code, then you get, and for instance, say you want to change the contrast range, then you get what you need to get the palette. So you need these arguments. For instance, TMap polygons also applies to lines and points or whatever. So say you want it just cites the first palette, but you can have any other palette, like this one I specified, just specified this one. But N is 16, contrast is that. So I just copy it, paste it over here. And then I have to stop the Shiny app, but okay, there it is. So yeah, I see that the contrast range is, so this is not very light color, so 0.5, very dark is 1. And this is the other part, so from very light to medium light. Yeah, so back to the Explorer again. So again, I set the three classes of variables, at least what I consider. So the sequential, categorical, diverging, so diverging plus or negative values. So let me show you a diverging palette. So if I do there's a variable, a happy planet index, which I normally use for illustrating. And you can just enter the name of a diverging color scheme. So for instance, this one, red, yellow, green, red, yellow, green. What it then does is, because you enter the name of a diverging color palette, it assumes that there are positive and negative values. So what it does is maps the mid color to 0, and one end of the palette to the positive and one end to the negative. So what you can do for here, I think I have it. So there's a variable, an argument called midpoint. I specify, okay, I have it here, sorry. So for instance, 25. So if I do it like that, then it doesn't work as expected. Let me check. Okay, yeah, so I have to look at it. So it doesn't work as expected. Let me check. I think there's an example of the same map somewhere over here. Yeah, so the map that I'll try to show is this one. Okay, so now I have the style is continuous, with the same palette. And yeah, this map. So I'm not sure why it didn't work before, but yeah.
Is there a way to invert the colors? So like not going from red to green, but from green to red?
Yeah.
Because sometimes it makes sense, depending on the values, just invert this color ramp.
Yeah, that's a thing, I think. What I came up with and what's being taken off by other packages is just put a minus sign here. So it's quite that works. So
yeah, cool.
Oh yeah, so one last thing about this Palette Explorer. So there are a couple of people, I think, I'm not sure how many, probably in this room also, that are colorblind. Or have a color deficiency. So there is some tools in R that do that. And what I did is just make use of those tools to have some color blindness simulator. And so there's the three main types of most common types of color blindness. And you can see how people perceive colors that have color deficiency. It's also because if you go to the color brewer website, they already take into account color blindness. So there's an option color blind safe, and they see already it eliminates, it should eliminate a couple of packages already. So if you deselect it, you get like 8 palettes, and if you select it, only 3 palettes. Okay, questions so far?
Sorry, what was the option for inverting?
Minus. So minus in before the palette name.
Before.
Yeah. There's not a maximum number, no. There are some options. That if you have more categories, so let me check. So for instance, if you create a variable, paste 0, x to n row world. So what I do is I create a variable which has x1 to x177. So suppose I want to plot it. It's polygons, a variable called x. Then you see that it does a couple of tricks. Oh yeah, it's you cannot read it really well. So what it did is stretches the palette. So you have two options: either the palette is like physically stretched apart, and it intermediate colors are blended colors are taken, or the palette is repeated. So these are two options. So this is the by palettes. Let me check. A stretch palette. So if stretch palette. So normally a qualitative color palette, it cannot have more than 12 colors, because otherwise, but if you do this, set this to false, what you then get is that the colors are repeated. Yeah. So this one has like 12 colors, and then the cyan, the first color is repeated again, and then another thing is that you don't see 170 categories, and so you see a warning. So what it says exactly is that is number of levels is 177, which is larger than max categories. So you can set max categories in TMAP options in order to show you all the values. So team options max categories is 200. If you do that, then you see 200 or 177 values. So yeah, for all those things, so I dive into to just one thing, but you can imagine that all of these arguments, they have specific behavior which you can change. And what I try to my main aim was to make it to use as much as possible. So I have many warnings and messages if there are things that I expect the user to be needed. So in this case, helpful warnings and messages. So questions? Thank you. Questions so far? Yeah, so what other things that's very important to TMap is the stacking of layers. So TM shape. So again, the polygons. Let's make them pink this time. And if I stack, for instance, this one, so the TM dots again. I'll repeat the map when I resize this one. So then I have stacked layers. But for the second layer, so the TM dots, I specified another shape object. So what I call shape is not necessarily an S3 shape, it's just spatial data in R. And it's the, so there are two classes supported from the SF or raster. And if it's SP, then it's converted to SF. If it's, so what I will do in a couple of months probably is other packages like Stera and Stars, so the upcoming packages, so to have like this embedded in TMap as well. Yeah, so projections, so you can specify projection over here. So it's projection. So I can, for instance, latitude, longitude, or Robinson. Versus Robin. Yeah, so you can have like any projection. I'm not sure if this one works, but yeah, on a projection. Yeah, so the so an S3, so this one is the S3 for latitude longitude. It has multiple, so the shape objects can have different projections. In that case, the projection of the first shape, so the first spatial object, is used. However, in view mode, the spatial objects are always plotted in latitude longitude. Why? Because the background tiles are available. So there are many background tiles available for latitude longitude, rendered for latitude longitude, which is not for other projections. I think in the future there'll be other projections with which have background tiles. Yeah, you can do it like that if you want. So what it does is first it checks whether the thing that you put between the double quotes is a variable of this data. So for instance, Happy Planet Index, then it recognizes the variable name and does that. If it doesn't, if it isn't a variable, then it checks whether it's a valid R color. And the R colors are either, yeah, so if you do the function colors, then you get a list of all the colors. But you can also do what I did just before, like in a color code. So
if you already have a variable, if you want to define separately colors but not palettes, then you have to put color equals.
If you want?
If you already define the variable in brackets, and
yeah,
then you later on want to define color without palettes, so you just use col? That's the
you mean you still want one variable to be plotted. And you want to specify a user palette or?
Yeah, if it's for color palettes, then it's just palette kind of function. No need to put in call, like call equals anything, but just palette, right?
I don't follow you. So.
Palette is the only option there for defining the colors.
Yeah, true.
There's no other like call, like color equals. Right?
Yeah, that's this one. This one is call. So I have two things, either call and palette.
Okay.
So either this one is a variable and this one specifies the colors for each class.
Yeah.
Or this one is a color and palette doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Okay, so for match, so, so let me put some extra aesthetics. So for if you go to the bubbles, if you go to the example of bubbles, so I just borrow one line which is in the examples, this one. So what I do is specify the growth rate of the metropolitan areas. So I do it like that. So you can to type it, you can also look into the health documentation of TM bubbles. And the second line in the examples shows you how to define the growth variable. So I can size pop 2020. Color is growth. And execute that one. And then I have to execute this one. So now I have three aesthetics. So the colors of the polygons, the sizes of the bubbles, and the color of the bubbles, the growth rate. So the there's a legend for the colors. Unfortunately, there's no legend for the size because it's not implemented in Leaflet. So it's quite, yeah, some works are just wait for others to do that, then I can make use of it. However, in plot mode, there is a. So let me increase the screen to see it. So then there's a legend of bubbles over here, and the legend for the color of the bubbles. And if you want, there's also. A shape, which specifies the shape of the bubbles, but this only applies to categorical data. So if you have multiple categories, they have similar to geom point. You can have like circles, triangles, squares, that kind of things. So that's the shape argument. It could be that that you need to run this line. Did you already? Yeah, so in the meantime, what I can do is so there's a team style. So, for instance, TM style classic, it turns the map into like a classic map. Beaver. So there are a couple of styles that are predefined. And also, if you go to the view mode, then so this style is the background color, the default color palettes, etc. You do it like this. I think similar to ggplot, ggplot theme, but because thematic map had to have another name, so TM style. You can also do a default to, you can also define a default style, it's TM underscore style, and then do black and white, for instance. And then there's this black and white map. And if you reset, yes, style white is the standard, but default style. So you can have like messages that you set the style to white and that there are other styles available. You can define your own style as well. So, but that's all in the documentation, and that's not like the main thing of TMAP. So I think this is the main thing, that you have a spatial object. You load it with the shape, and then you have these layers, and layers always start with TM underscore. So for instance, you can have a map compass. Not sure if I'm not in viewing mode, so I have to go into plot mode again. So then you see a compass over here. You can change location, of course. Yeah, so raster is same thing. It's TM shape land. So land is a raster. TM raster, for instance, cover class. It's a variable. It's one of the layers. And then you have this raster over here, or in thematic, often in a view mode, same. And you can also stack it the same way. TM dots. Or what you can also do is TM shape world. Do the borders of the countries on top, and then the metropolitan areas in red. Or else I think I'll like it in black. So then you get this map. Let me think, it looks a little bit better in view mode. Full screen. Yeah, so what I did is like a raster map of the cover class. Then on top, country borders. And suppose I want the borders a little bit thicker, then I just increase the LBD line width. Yeah, so there are. Yeah, you can find it out. I think for the main special objects. So if I go to the presentation again. Oh yeah, so this one. So this is just like a summary of how the plot is defined. So TM shape is this one. So there are basically four types, main types, but there are a lot of derivatives. So for instance, ISO lines. It's a combination of lines and labels. Labels is another one, but labels is actually point, but rather than a point, you print a name. There is borders, which is basically a polygon without fill. There's a TM fill, which is a polygon without the borders. So in a sense, there are more TM layers than there are basic ones. But yeah, so yeah, all the functions that start with TM underscore you can use as in your plot syntax. And all functions with TM underscore, they're either output functions or style functions or helper functions. So yeah, so let me finish this presentation before the coffee break. Then we can see your own data. So I did this already. Oh, zoom. Yeah, so the theme is this one, and facets. So facets, either you specify, so what I showed is that you can specify a color or a variable name. If you specify more variable names, you just get more maps, either in interactive or view mode. If you, but you can also do it more in ggplot style, this one. So if you have data set, the crimes data, so crimes data of London City, grouped by type of crime. So you cannot, probably cannot read it, but antisocial behavior, bicycle theft, burglary, and it just shows you the points of the crimes for each crime type. So there is this. So if for those of you after the break who want to continue with this data set, on the workshop page, so I have to click a couple of times, but on the workshop page, so there's this link to the paper. And if you go there, then there's a link to the data, so the fourth one, this one. So it's a CSV file of 200 MB. And on the TMAP page, so there's this in this demo folder. Now let me increase the font size a little bit. So this GitHub MTenicus TMAP. So there's this demo. And then London crimes. Then you see the reproducible script, which you can see how the data is processed. This is a reproducible script for the paper. And this section. So if you run this code, so this get crimes data just reads the data. Of course, you can do it by yourself. You can extract the zip file and read CSVs, but you can also do it like that. Read into SF. So this is basically, so if you, this is also quite interesting. If you have a CSV file, so with read.csv, you can turn it into an SF object by this line. So STSSF, then your normal data frame, then you specify the columns that contain the latitude and longitude. Normally you specify the coordinate system as well, so CRS. And then you have your SF object with spatial points. So that's, yeah, probably I'll have to repeat it after the break, because this one is quite important if you have like a CSV file with coordinates and you want it into an SF object. So, okay, so let's do a break for, yeah. Oh, yeah, how to reach this page. Yeah, so in this main page of TMAP, so the GitHub page of TMAP, so there's this folder demo. And these are, demo scripts. London crimes is the one of the crime data. So you can either follow, if you follow this code, it won't run because data isn't processed. So what you then do is click on this link, and then it opens the script. Okay, so let's have a break.
Also, can you show in our console how to write to put the border?
Yeah, like this. So you first specify the raster object, and then the what kind of raster layer you want to visualize. So this is cover class. We can also do elevation. Now you have elevation. And after you specify the raster, you specify again the country border, the countries, so the polygons. And rather than TM polygons, you do TM borders. And this is for the dots.
Since there's TM polygons, is there also TM points?
Yeah.
And what's the difference?
TM points is TM.
Same dots.
It's the same. There's no TM points, so it's just TM dots. What you can do, instead of, okay, and maybe one thing before the break then. You can also do this. And rather than have a polygon, special polygons plotted as polygons, also have polygons plotted as dots. They have like a dot exactly, the centroid. So now you have just a centroid per country. But there are countries, for instance France, that have the centroid over here, because there are some islands in the Caribbean. In order to cope with that, there are some tricks. So you can have the largest polygon, etc., but I will not go into it. So if you have, but yeah, so that's essentially the thing. Okay, cool. So a break.